Hello, my knowledge-thirsty peeps. Welcome to Edinburgh's second winter, second out of probably about four. This is Kat, aka Kakibot, and today I thought, due to the weather, I would take you to the National Museum of Scotland, where I think we've been there before, but today we're gonna make it bigger and better. The National Museum of Scotland is one of my favorite attractions here in Edinburgh, so why not? It is free, it is fully accessible since 2011 when it reopened after quite a big reconstruction. And honestly, there's basically a bit of everything in there, which you're gonna see in a little bit. So follow me and I'll show you all of my faves. Okay, so I bet that it's immediately noticeable to you that the museum kind of consists of two different buildings. One of them very old, very beautiful, and the other one quite modern. So now we have entered the old-timey pretty one. This building opened in 1866 as the Museum of Art and Science, or Science and Art, one of those. And it was actually designed by the same architect who is responsible for the Victoria and Albert Museum down in London and also the Royal Albert Hall. So that's something that I found really interesting. When you first enter the museum through this old museum entrance, you will be met by this like cellar-like space, which used to be a storage space for this old museum. And later on in 1996, they have built the extra bit of the museum, the modern one, which now houses the Scotland collection, which is basically the history of Scotland from the very beginning to now, and also on top has really nice views, which we will show you later. Now, the modern part of the museum apparently is inspired both by kind of like old-timey Scottish architecture, by like spiral staircases and such. And you will, when you're in there, feel a bit like you're in an old castle, because compared to this building, the old one, it does feel quite small, a tiny bit more claustrophobic, which I'm not sure if I love, but if it's supposed to reflect that sort of medieval feeling, then it's doing that very well. It's also supposedly inspired by the French architect Le Corbusier, which in my opinion, if you want to see something very Corbusier-ish, you should go to Leith and see the banana flats.
Now, let's talk a bit about accessibility. In 2011, the old building has undergone a lot of changes that now make the museum very accessible. You'll find elevators, couple of escalators, and also accessible bathrooms. Now, the museum layout can still be a bit labyrinthine, so most definitely pick up a map to find the most accessible route for your needs. But rest assured that this is a certified wheelchair-accessible attraction. The museum website has a whole page on accessibility, so I recommend checking that out, but as a little summary, I'll mention that there is a monthly relaxed morning, which is when the sounds are turned down to make the setting less taxing for visitors with autism, dementia, and others who might struggle with all that sensory input. Both entrance desks also have sensory backpacks and ear defenders for children and adults alike to borrow. Also, the accessibility page has a sensory map showing you which parts of the museum get busy, loud or bright, which is amazing. The museum has two places to eat, one in the sort of vaults just next to the entrance, the other one is the cafe up on the balconies. Both are kind of on the expensive side, as it tends to be with museum cafes. So, you know, to be expected. I thought that the selection was really good, but if you want to bring your own food, that's completely fine as well. The museum website specifically says that, and I did notice during my little touring for this video that there's more than one sort of appointed places where you can sit down and munch on your Tesco meal deal or similar.
Fun fact, did you know that this space has actually been featured on Accidentally Wes Anderson, which I kind of also accidentally worked with when I was putting my outfit together today. I feel like it's a bit Wes adjacent. Anyway, now we're in the main hall and we are surrounded by pretty much all of the collection except the historical one, which is a bit further away. And there is just so much to see here. I almost get overwhelmed when I come here or when I bring someone here. So I thought a good thing to do in this particular video would be to put together a list of 10 plus some extras of my favorite exhibits here at the National Museum of Scotland. Let's go see them.
Perfect. personally, I always tend to gravitate towards the natural world part of the museum first. I mean, it's hard not to when that T-Rex is luring me in with his boyish grin. He really is the Ewan McGregor of late Cretaceous. I just think this area is super precious and very kid-friendly. Well, maybe except for the two rats really getting it on floor two. This whole part of the museum is a must-not-miss in my book. But if I had to point your attention to one thing, it would probably be the animal scales, because it's just a fun interactive thing to do with your family. And I know that scales can be the opposite of fun times for people, so I recommend testing it out in a group, seeing if you can collectively Voltron into a porpoise or a bear.
Let's go together. Bear.
The natural world section has this space-centric part as well, where we will find our second highlight, which is the Muonionalusta meteorite. Wow, that is a mouthful. This highly magnetic rock, which came to us from deep space via Sweden, can actually be touched in this museum. I just think that it's neat that you can touch a meteorite that came from actual far space. World cultures part of the museum is like a little trip around the world in 30 or 45 minutes. My one interesting fact for this area will be that this was the first museum gallery to rematriate a totem pole back to its original owners, the Nisga tribe of Canada. From what I've seen, this is a part of a wider trend around Scotland, since Glasgow museums seem to have been processing returns of artifacts since the 1990s. Also, do not miss the Millennium Clock. This is a one-of-a-kind piece of work, a collaboration of multiple inspired Scottish artisans. Apart from the wood, everything used to build this clockwork has come from Scotland's scrapyards. Entering the art, design and fashion section, I have a little fun fact for you. For the longest time, I have not known that you can see a genuine piece of Picasso at the National Museum, and I feel like you might miss it if you're not looking for it. It's this glass sculpture called La Capra, or the goat, and it has cost the museum over £22,000. Picasso's glasswork is really rare to see unless you're a real art obsessive, so this is possibly the only piece of it you can see in the UK. Continuing on, we're getting into the science and technology area, the last one we'll explore in the old museum building. This is a very hands-on part of the museum, which I am sure kids will love, or, you know, you will love if you're like me, just very tempted by anything that's touchable. Of course, the biggest celebrity of this section is Dolly the Sheep. If you are a 90s kiddo like me, this will blast you right into your science-obsessed tot past. If you were a fully formed adult in 1996, did this give you the heebie-jeebies the same way AI art gives us now? I'm actually really curious about that. World War II history has always been a bit of a special interest to me, so I am also gonna point you towards the German Enigma machine, which can be seen in the communicate part of this section. This particular 1944 model would be used on German submarines and represents the most advanced model of an Enigma machine. It comes with more interchangeable rotors than previous models, and here in Edinburgh you can see those in great condition too, which is unusual. The last section is simply called Scotland and is housed in the 1998 building. I find it a bit too hard to navigate just because it is more tightly packed with almost no windows, so my tip would be not to go rogue and instead follow the chronological order in which the building is laid out. A lovely piece I only really noticed recently is the Queen Mary Harp. Not only is the instrument itself in an exquisite condition, really inviting you to explore the artisanal work, but also the protective case is an absolute stunner itself. This harp has been archaeologically proven to be one of the oldest European string instruments you can still see in a museum, and of course has a Scottish backstory of its own, which is that it was a gift from Mary Queen of Scots to Beatrix Gardine of Banchory, although recent findings are stepping away from this again. So you will hardly be surprised that I am making the Lewis chessmen a part of this video, as these little dudes are printed all over this museum's souvenirs. These were most likely made in Norway, but were found on the Isle of Lewis as a part of a much larger hoard. They were made of walrus ivory and whale teeth, and I love how expressive they are. Now let us get spooky. One of my favorite bone-chilling Edinburgh stories is the one about the tiny coffins, a bunch of boys found atop Arthur's Seat in early 19th century. To this day, we do not quite know why they were there or who made them. We have nothing but a long history of people trying to figure this out, including the 19th century journalists who were quite sure this simply must have been witchcraft. In early 20th century, there has also been a theory that this was but a little hoard of talismans to be sold to superstitious sailors. However, we do not have any specific proof of tiny coffins being a type of such good luck charm in Scotland. This might also be a little symbolic burial of Birkenhair's victims, as the timeline for that kinda checks out, and the number of victims fits the number of coffins. Which theory is your favorite? Okay, enough dark history, let's just tie things up to where we started. Yes, Ewan McGregor. Towards the end of the Scotland Museum exhibition, you will find a script to the movie Trainspotting, released in 1993. It has been signed and donated by the Scottish actor, and you know what, I think it's a great reminder that Edinburgh hasn't always been this dark academia, Instagrammable heaven, but also a gritty city tackling drug problems.
Now, of course, for many people, especially people who live here and hence have been in this museum multiple times, this viewing deck is the top one highlight, and I wanted to make sure that it is in this video, just so you don't miss out on it, even though it is quite hard to miss, because whenever you see the elevator, it's gonna say, this goes to the deck. So it will kind of like light up that little bulb in you about not forgetting. Although I'm just gonna say, if you are super duper looking forward to coming to this deck, just make sure you don't come on kind of like a very bad weather day, because when it's windy or super rainy and especially icy, they will close it off. So, you know, if you're going to the museum because the weather is bad, that might come and bite you in the butt. So just a local tip. On a busy day, it might be pretty hard to get into the elevator going up here. So I would also recommend looking for the alternative way, which is the pedestrian way. If you can take stairs, then I believe that from level 5, you can take kind of like 2 layers of stairs up here and avoid the elevator altogether.
You If you enjoyed this video, which has been based on what I personally find interesting and fun to read about, touch and photograph, you might also want to check out the audio guides available for this museum. For example, the LGBTQIA+ Hidden Histories audio trail, which can be found through the Smartify app alongside Highlights Trail and the Wellbeing Trail, which might be great if you're just looking for a little mindful reset.
Those were my 10 favorite bits here in the National Museum of Scotland. And some extras as well, especially the little Lego museum. That's a big extra for me. I love coming back and having a look at the little minifigures. Anywho, when I was putting this list together, I was trying to make it relevant to anyone who's interested in Scotland, but also I wanted to kind of imbue it with my own personality and interests. Therefore, I think that many of you might have a totally different top 10 list, and I would love to know about it. Which ones are your favorite exhibits here in Edinburgh's National Museum of Scotland? Now, even though I tried very hard not to make it look like it, we did have to make this video over 2 days, because there, even if you do boil things down to only 10 things you want to see, there is just so much going on. It is wild. This place is huge. If you ever are visiting Edinburgh and you think to yourself, "Oh, I've been there before, I don't need to go again," I think you should rethink that attitude. Okay, now I'm truly gonna end this video. I am very warm. This is a warm museum. I'm looking forward to going out and getting some breeze. Don't forget, you can visit me on Instagram under KakiBot and KakiBlog. And also, if you like what I do, if you'd like to support my creative endeavors and my ability to buy groceries, you can visit me on Patreon. This is the address. You can support me there by simply sending me $3 a month, or maybe $6, and then you'll get an extra video every month. Win! Okay, I need air, so I'm gonna end this now, and I shall see you soon. Bye!